Just a reminder to our Speculating Wildly About Crime listeners, this is for entertainment purposes only and solely the thoughts and opinions of our team. We do invite you to sit back, relax, and enjoy the show.
Just an FYI for you all, we had so much to discuss on this case that we're splitting it in two. The second episode will release next week, so mark your calendars and we'll see you back here. You will not want to miss our wild speculations.
Hi, everyone. I'm Janelle, and I'll be your host this week. We have a case for you that is very near and dear to our hearts. We first discussed the unbelievable death of Phoebe Handschuck years ago, and she is still a huge topic in our conversations. We are heading to a place where we haven't taken you before, Australia. Let's discuss the mysterious and quite unbelievable death of Phoebe Handschuck. I also want to say there's an incredible podcast called Phoebe's Fall where I got a lot of my research, so highly suggest a listen. And this episode is going to get really name heavy, so I'm going to omit names that aren't really necessary for you. However, I do have some names that you should take note of, so I'm not constantly saying who these people were to Phoebe. Phoebe's mom, Natalie Handschuck. Phoebe's dad, Lynn Handschuck, Natalie's mother, so Phoebe's grandmother, and her biggest confidant, Jeanette Campbell, Natalie's dad, so Phoebe's granddad, Lorne Campbell. I want to start with a quote from Natalie, who says her daughter was someone who drove through life like she stole it. Not only was Phoebe incredibly athletic and competitive in school, she was also very creative and artistic, always working on an art project and never without her journal. Friends describe her personality as magnetic or a live wire, almost otherworldly. But it sounds like Phoebe wasn't always comfortable with the spotlight and this kind of attention. Maybe this contributed to her dabbling with drugs and alcohol in her early teen years. I'm talking like her club days started at 13. Her father, who is a psychiatrist, noticed that her mood swings may need some regulation, so he urged her to see a doctor, and she was prescribed an antidepressant. And then I want to note here that the age of consent in Australia is 16, because at around 16 years old, Phoebe began a relationship with a 30-year-old teacher. Now, both Phoebe's mom and grandmother had dated and married older men, so it sounds like they weren't all that concerned. And this relationship did last for 2 years. Her family also openly discusses that Phoebe had a tendency to develop infatuations with older men. There was a married man that lived next door to which she had a sort of obsession about. And even later, when she and a future boyfriend were living together, she demanded that one of her art teachers have an affair with her. He accused her of stalking, and she was kicked out of art school. So by her late teens, her drinking was pretty out of control, to the point where it was common for her to injure herself from falling or accidentally cutting herself. She always assured her family that these were accidents and she did not want to harm herself. Phoebe was also an avid martial artist, doing kickboxing and karate training. Sarah Howitt, one of Australia's top female boxers, grew close to Phoebe as they trained together. She recounts that Phoebe was on the fast track to get her black belt in 2 years, meaning her days at the gym lasted for 8 hours at times. For me, it's hard to imagine this crazed binge drinker, as she was called, having the determination to put in this much work. But much like everything else in Phoebe's life, nothing was as expected. So in mid-2009, Phoebe is 23 when she meets 42-year-old Anthony Hampel, who goes by Ant. They met at a hair salon where Ant was a client and Phoebe was working as a receptionist. Now, Ant was a big deal. He owned an events management company called A-Live Events, and they had pretty high-profile clients and celebrity connections. Plus, Ant's father was a former Supreme Court judge And his stepmother was a current city county judge. So we've got some political connections as well. You can imagine the lifestyle he was accustomed to and some amount of entitlement that came with it. And just to note, Phoebe's typical type was more of a grungy, think lead singer of a band kind of guy, not A-list high society like Aunt. So this was a totally new world for her. The relationship moves extremely quickly, and Aunt asks Phoebe to move in with him after 5 months. Now, Aunt lives in an upscale high-rise building called the Balencia in Melbourne. And this building has 23 floors total, with Aunt on the 12th floor. So, some notes about the Balencia. The key fob system was pretty advanced. It sounds like you need it for entry from the front or the garage, plus in the elevator to access your floor, and of course, your apartment door. So this is when we see some controlling behaviors coming out. It is said that Aunt didn't feel like a receptionist was equally matched to his own status. So she was forced to quit, and he gets her a job at a friend's advertising agency. Now, she was only working 3 days a week here, so not a situation where she is stockpiling money. Even though she was paying Aunt $150 a week for rent, there is still a huge gap in financial status, and she's backing herself into a corner where she's dependent on him.
Wait, time out. So she's paying $150 a week. So that's $600 a month to share an apartment, but this is back in 2010, right?
I'm sure that wasn't even covering
like a quarter of it.
I would bet not even close to a quarter.
Okay.
Aunt was very type A. He was a workaholic and liked things done in a certain way. His former house cleaner said that he wanted the apartment to appear that no one lived there. It was described as a controlled atmosphere. And Phoebe was included in that. So no personal items, none of her artwork. Other than a few photos of them together, there was literally no sign of Phoebe in that building. I imagine it was a very cold feeling inside the apartment. I was shocked to learn that he allowed a cat and a dog in this apartment. Regardless, Phoebe starts to distance herself from friends and is taking to this completely different lifestyle. She's now frequenting red carpet gala events when she'd probably be more comfortable at a dive bar in jeans. I just can't even imagine the imposter syndrome symptoms she was feeling. She told her therapist that Aunt put her down and made her feel stupid. Also that he was controlling and jealous. Her drinking was a big piece of contention in their relationship. But again, she's going to these events where she's not comfortable. So what does she do while he's rubbing elbows? She drinks. She had been diagnosed with major depressive disorder, anxiety disorder, and while not full-blown, there were definitely some elements of borderline personality disorder. Symptoms of BPD are intense mood swings, recklessness, impulsivity, paranoia, just to name a few. Add on top of this, substance abuse issues, including alcohol and what is described as party drugs. Also, she would often go on and off of her antidepressants, which is, of course, super risky. Phoebe was really open about her drug use, and even her grandmother said, "Hey, with the way that your brain works, maybe LSD is not the best idea." So in the fall of 2010, her relationship with Aunt begins to really show some serious cracks. One of Phoebe's big concerns was him proposing. They had a trip to Paris planned in late December, and she was terrified that this was his plan. They actually broke up and made up an estimated 4 times in the 6 weeks before her death. According to her family, she loved Aunt, but recognized that it wasn't a healthy situation, and eventually she just couldn't handle it. Whether it was the money he constantly held over her head, or just the controlling nature in general. So she leaves and stays at her mom's house for a bit, who was traveling at the time, and then plans to move in with her grandmother, who lived about 6 hours away in Mallacoota. While visiting her grandmother, Phoebe actually lines up a future job at the yacht club and attends an AA meeting. She's doing so much better. She's discussing plans for the future. And while great advice at the time, and unfortunately her grandmother's biggest regret, she tells Phoebe to go back and do things the right way. Formally quit your job. Break up with Aunt properly. Then you can build your next steps without burdens. So she returns to Melbourne and, of course, gets lured back in by Aunt. Not long after, she changes her mind and a mutual friend actually helps Phoebe pack up and move out while Aunt is at work. Not long after, she moves back in. Days later, Aunt kicks her out and then begs her to come back. It sounds like torture, just emotionally exhausting, but she was always persuaded to come back.
So how long again was the period of time that they did this on again, off again, on again, off again?
It was about 6 weeks where it was okay. Really brutal. Not that things were amazing before then. I think there were always some kind of issues. The week of Sunday evening, Phoebe Skypes with Natalie, who again was traveling at the time. She remembers that there was no light in the room, just Phoebe's face lit by the laptop. They discuss decorations for Phoebe's brother's birthday party the following weekend. Natalie inquires about Aunt and if they've patched things up. Phoebe lifts her finger to shush her and says, "Aunt and I are just watching a movie." This would be the last time she saw or spoke with Phoebe. So then Monday morning, Phoebe meets Lynn for their weekly breakfast date. His birthday was actually the next day, and his birthday gathering was on Wednesday night. Phoebe explains that she and Aunt won't make the party because they had tickets to U2, but offers to take him to birthday dinner on Thursday night at her favorite Thai restaurant, the Golden Triangle. That evening, Aunt and Phoebe are going to dinner with friends of his. They had a conversation about her drinking prior to leaving. Phoebe promises best behavior, but this turned out to not be the case. She gets a bit tipsy and opens up about her struggle with depression, which severely embarrassed Aunt. He cut the dinner short. They have a screaming match in the parking garage, which continues up to the apartment. Aunt locks himself in the bedroom, and Phoebe makes a series of phone calls. One to a friend to ask if she could crash there tonight. One to Natalie's boyfriend, so her kind of stepdad, and another to a male friend. They agreed to meet for drinks in an hour. So I want to note here that Phoebe actually had two phones, a Nokia that was hers, and an iPhone 3 that Aunt paid for. Now, while she and this friend are catching up, Aunt is calling both phones over and over. Records show 27 calls from Aunt in a 1 hour time period. Phoebe is actually so frustrated that she throws her iPhone across the street on their way out before retrieving it. She then goes to Natalie's house to stay the night. Tuesday mid-morning, Phoebe returns to the Balencia after Aunt left for work. She makes calls to a crisis center hotline, her primary care physician, and also her psychologist to see if she can get an emergency appointment. Unfortunately, there was no availability. She later recounts that this was the first time Phoebe's mental state caused concern for her. Later this afternoon, she meets another male friend for coffee. He says she was in absolutely great spirits and then asked him to take her to buy drugs. When she took some ecstasy, she started to have intense and violent mood swings. So he says, "I'm taking you back." Mid-drive, she demands to be let out, and her whereabouts are unknown for about 3 hours before actually returning to the Balencia. So Wednesday morning, according to Aunt, Phoebe is sleeping when he leaves for work. He later says he takes her iPhone 3, which had been broken, probably when she threw it, and planned to take it to be repaired. However, family and friends receive a super odd text at 10:33 a.m. So this goes to her mom, dad, aunt, her brothers, her grandmother, her boss. But it says, Hi, family. I am in bed and about to sleep, and when I wake, I will transform into the most incredible human being you've ever seen. Not. I will go to the hospital. It's safer there, and I hear the special tonight is tomato soup. Delicious, nutritious. I love you all very much, but not enough to send an individual text. Sorry about that, but time is sleep and I must be on my way. Merrily, 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 life is but a dream, XO. Her grandmother actually calls Anthony shortly after at 10:35 a.m. to check on Phoebe. He responds that she seemed fine when he left that morning. Now, what I find odd is that this text message was sent from the phone that Aunt claimed to have taken that morning. So more on this later. He offers to go back and check on her, says that Phoebe told him that she took two Stilnox, which is what we would call Ambien. So he took the bottle with him when he left, so she didn't take any more. However, there is no record of Aunt in the building around this time. It only shows when he left that morning and returned that evening. Because remember, there's a tracker on the key fob. Aunt's weekly housekeeper arrives around 2:15 p.m. She seemed quite fond of Phoebe and later goes on record to say that she didn't approve of how Aunt treated Phoebe. She said it was more of a parent and child relationship. Being a weekly employee, she has her own key fob that allows access to the building. She notices that Phoebe is asleep in the master bedroom, so she quietly cleans everything else, and then once the master is left, she knocked, and Phoebe comes out seeming fine. However, when she finishes the bedroom, Phoebe goes back in to bed. She leaves around 5 p.m. Now, according to Aunt, he gets home around 7:30. He claims he drew a bath for her, gave her a massage, and made dinner for them. Phoebe calls Lynn around 8 p.m. to wish him a happy birthday, which was the day before. And tonight is his birthday party. So apparently they skipped the U2 concert. So we get to Thursday. Jeanette received a text from Aunt at 8:30 a.m. after asking how Phoebe was doing today. Quote, "She is sleeping beauty right now and not the beast she was. Resting well, and I've explained now is the time to heal. When she feels okay, we'll work out a plan." So there are two false fire alarms set off by construction workers this day, and all floors are evacuated for the first one. Aunt is already gone, but Phoebe is captured on camera leaving with her dog at 11:43 a.m. and re-entering the building around 11:50. So here is the footage.
The first and last anyone sees of her is when a fire alarm at 11:43 a.m. has the entire building evacuated. But it's a false alarm, and she returns to the building 7 minutes later.
The second alarm goes off at 6:05 p.m., but the building is not evacuated. So remember, this is the night they are supposed to be meeting Phoebe's father, Lynn, for dinner. Swipe records show Aunt enters the building at 6:09 p.m. He can't recall if the door was locked or unlocked, but there's broken glass on the kitchen floor. There are two other glasses on the counter, which he says smelled like vodka, along with Phoebe's purse and keys. He continues to the bedroom where he finds what he calls a shrine on the bed. There are pictures and nonsensical messages on post-it notes. Aunt later claims that when Phoebe was drunk, this was something she did. Rambling messages on post-its everywhere. Her flat iron was on, insinuating that she was getting ready to go out, probably for dinner with her dad. There were candles burning. Blood was also found on her computer mouse pad and another small amount on a doorframe. Am I an overreactor, or would y'all be making phone calls too?
No, definitely making phone calls at this point.
Definitely not doing what he's about to do.
But yeah, there's blood at a minimum. I'm calling her to say, where the fuck are you? This is really weird.
Records show that Aunt is on his computer for at least 15 minutes. Lynn calls Phoebe's iPhone at 6:51 p.m., which, again, is supposed to be at the repair shop, to discuss dinner plans, and the call goes to voicemail. Immediately after he hangs up, his phone rings and it's Aunt calling. A big deal is made of the fact that this is the first time Aunt has ever called Lynn. Now, Aunt says that Phoebe's iPhone was actually getting repaired that day and was not at the apartment, and it was just a coincidence that the calls were almost at the same time. I don't know about you, but that is a wild coincidence to me, especially with this being the first time Aunt has ever called Lynn.
Maybe it is this crazy coincidence that you just happened to call her dad for the first time ever. But I have problems with that, because if you truly were calling her dad out of concern, why did you sit on your computer for, what, 15 minutes?
Aunt says that Phoebe isn't home, but assumes she is nearby because her keys and purse are in the apartment. They speak for about 3.5 minutes. He does not mention broken glass and blood. Lynn immediately has a bad gut feeling and is already in full panic mode. He tells Aunt to report her missing. Aunt responds with something to the effect of, they don't listen until 48 hours have passed and she'll be back by then. Still, Lynn is unnerved and is calling the entire world to see if anybody has seen or heard from Phoebe. Any guesses on what Aunt does during this time?
Nothing.
I know, and it irritates the fuck out of me.
He orders takeout for one from the exact restaurant that they had planned to meet Lynn at that night, the Golden Triangle.
I am sorry, sir, but if you are so distraught that your girlfriend is fucking missing, how can you even eat?
The thing is, he supposedly believes Phoebe is just going to walk in the door any second and that they're going to head to
the dinner.
The Golden Triangle.
So then that again.
Why order takeout from the place that you are about to be going to?
Just fucking bizarre.
He was just really set on that restaurant.
If you really, truly believe, shit, she might not come back tonight, but she'll probably be back in 48 hours. I'm really fucking hungry and I was really craving this. Can you at least call the dad back and say, hey, I don't think we're going to make dinner tonight, because you just talked to him. So it's not going to be awkward for you to call him again, right?
I don't even understand, like, why he called the dad. It's so interesting.
If he paid for her phone, and maybe he had the tracker or something on her phone, so like he could track when she got phone calls, or like who she was getting phone calls from. If dad just called her phone that he supposedly took to the shop to have fixed, but he has a notification going to his phone.
Right.
So maybe he's actually able to see what phone call she's getting, if he's really a controlling person like she was saying he was.
Okay, so thought on that. Maybe the phone really was at the shop, and to Missy's point, he had some kind of notification coming through, whether it was on his computer or his own phone, and he just saw a number come through. And he just called that number and is like, who the fuck is calling her right now? Let me figure this out.
Yeah.
Because your girl had a little jealous streak on her at one point in time in life, and I did just that.
Right around 7 p.m., the building's concierge went to a storage area in the basement to grab a broom. And obviously this area held various cleaning supplies, but also a trash compactor. When she attempted to open the door, it was jammed or blocked by something. So she finally gets the door to budge, and once the light sensor recognizes the door has been opened, she sees one of the 5 trash bins has been tipped on its side. She then sees the body of a bloody, dark-haired woman, blood on the walls, and multiple blood trails around the room. She informs her boss, who instructs her to immediately call the police. Shortly after 8 p.m., Aunt's food delivery guy arrives and tells Aunt that something is happening downstairs. The building is blocked off. There's police everywhere. Aunt goes down to see what's going on and is told that the body of a woman has been found. Aunt told police his girlfriend was missing and it was likely her. Who jumps to that conclusion? Aunt says that was the moment he just knew it was Phoebe. So he compares notes with police on her tattoos to get a basic confirmation. So this is when Lynn receives his second call ever from Aunt to say that Phoebe had been located and was no longer alive. Lynn is given the impossible task of letting the family know this horrific news. And as it spreads, everyone is, of course, devastated and shocked. It was determined that Phoebe died from falling 12 floors down the building's trash chute, sustaining a severe cut from the trash compactor that nearly severed her foot. They believe she reached the floor alive, but bled to death while crawling to the door. Blood patterns show that she was trying to get out of the room or get help. The coroner's report will later make the assumption that this would have happened in 5 to 10 minutes. The last time anyone saw or spoke to Phoebe was the camera footage from the fire alarm, making the time of death window quite a large 7 hours. Come to find out, and I hope you all had your daily Xanax, of all the people who came in contact with Phoebe, the concierge that found her, first responders, investigators, no one ever checked to see if she was still alive. No one touched her body to see what the body temp was. We have no idea how long she was down there. One of the paramedics claimed that when she arrived on scene, the door was being blocked by police and she was prevented from rendering aid as this was officially a crime scene. She observed the body of a woman with cuts to her hips, thigh, and foot, and she had a bluish tint. No medical professional was able to examine her between the time she was found and the time she was removed from the room several hours later. Phoebe's jeans had been pulled to below her knees. Her underwear and bra were in place. She was barefoot with one foot hanging on by a few tendons. There were lacerations on her legs, back, and buttocks. Also, her sunglasses were found with her, so she was either wearing them or had them on her. Not the weirdest thing here, but why bring sunglasses if her intention was to go down the chute?
When we watched the video with her leaving because of the fire alarm, was there sunglasses on her head then? I feel like I remember seeing that.
Yeah.
Okay. So that is something that she may just have with her on top of her head on a regular basis and potentially then, right?
Potentially, yeah.
That's not the case, but it like gives me Ray Rivera vibes.
That's exactly what I was thinking. I was like, we're back to Janelle's type of stories. We got sunglasses. We have tall buildings.
Not a she in a hotel?
Damn near the same.
So I want to talk about the room she was found in. From what I've gathered, and I'll have some pics for you later, the chute comes down and there are 5 large garbage bins and they're on some kind of conveyor belt or carousel. So the compactor compacts and then imagine as one can fills up, the conveyor moves a fresh can over. So one of the bins was tipped over, so we can assume that's where she fell and then climbed or crawled out of. Blood was found on and in the compactor. The manufacturer of the compactor is adamant that if she came down and the compactor was on automatic mode, the damage to Phoebe would have been so much worse, and there's no way she would have survived the compactor. Apparently, there was a huge blade that chopped the trash and then compressed it before passing through to the garbage bin. In photos taken after Phoebe was found, the setting was on automatic. Speculation is that it had to be turned to manual and then back to auto. Police theorized that Phoebe cut herself on the broken glass in her kitchen and then had gone to the garbage chute to dispose of the broken glass. However, no shards matching what was found in the apartment were found near her body. No blood was found near the glass or on or around the chute. Blood was found on the door to the trash room and in the trash room. This blood was not tested. Muddy shoe prints were found leading away from apartment 1201, which was their apartment. It is suspected that this was from either a tall person or someone running, based on the spacing between the prints. And floors are mopped daily, so these were thought to be fresh footprints.
In the hallway, you said, of the 12th floor?
leading away from their apartment.
Was there any surveillance cameras in this hallway? Being a very expensive building, I would assume there should be.
Yes, there actually was. I'll get there in a second.
All right, I'll put a pin in it then.
An officer recounted noticing these prints, but they were never photographed or sampled. Not only were the entrance and exits to the building not secured, Aunt and Phoebe's apartment was wide open to whoever. Police later confirmed that during this initial search, Aunt's parents and friends showed up and were just roaming around the apartment. So something to note, every fourth floor is a fire escape, so these doors are unlocked. If someone wanted to climb up or down, they could have accessed the 12th floor. Aunt immediately sold the suicide narrative to police and pretty much everyone around him. As soon as her body was discovered, he is on record telling the police that Phoebe took her life tonight. They hadn't even made a determination, and he's not even waiting to see what an investigation would look like.
Or she's beneficially declared dead because has anybody touched her fucking body?
She wasn't officially declared dead until 4:30 a.m. on December 3rd.
Aunt's claiming suicide at what, 10 p.m.?
He was claiming it ever since they said they found a body. He was
She was declared dead 9.5 hours after she was found. And again, no one checked to see if there were signs of life in those hours. So at 4:55 a.m., a fingerprint expert arrived at the building. The main door to the trash room was dusted, along with the actual door to the chute, a sign above the chute, and the door to the compactor room. No usable prints were found. And this is just so sketchy to me. First, this is a public space, so there should have been like a plethora of prints. But maybe
but that's... You said no usable prints.
Right.
So they all might have been smudged, but right. A ton of them.
So maybe there were too many to really make a determination, but it just sounds so wild to me. And you'll come to see more of that when we watch some videos later. Some sources imply that the area had been cleaned and there were literally zero prints to pull. Another officer took over 100 photos of the scene and the apartment. Police made no mention or observation of this shrine. No other work was done until Monday, December 6th. Here you go, Carolina. The manager of the Balencia informed police that if they needed CCTV footage, it should be requested immediately since it was recorded on a loop that was only lasting a few days rather than the normal full week due to a glitch. No other video footage was requested. Police. And by the time they do ask the building, after being pushed by Phoebe's family, the footage had been recorded over.
That is so frustrating.
I don't know anything about this story. I don't know why, but in my head, the story I created is that she was missing and not deceased. Hearing this was a big punch in my gut. A. B. There was two fire alarms, right? One, people evacuated the building. So they were probably having to stay in the yard and all these places. And they figure out if they can go back in. So couldn't that be why there's muddy footprints being found potentially because of all the traffic and people having to abruptly leave because of a fire alarm? Because it was in the span of a few hours, right?
Yeah, the first one was like at 11:45 and the second one was right after 6.
Okay, so... But that could maybe explain why it hadn't been cleaned up yet then, right?
But then I guess why would they only note that it was outside that apartment? If it was like outside every apartment where multiple people walk through the mud. And it could have been like she just walked through this one muddy spot. That's definitely plausible.
Yeah, probably good point. Probable, I guess I was thinking it was right? Like just in the hall between all the apartments. But yeah, you're right. That was said that it was directed toward their apartment.
Yeah, but if she was going out for the fire, if that's where she got mud, you're not supposed to take the elevator during a fire. So she would have had to walk up flights of stairs and in the hallway and stuff. So her feet would have been clean by the time she got to her apartment.
But most fire alarms
Only because I've been in corporate buildings and had to go down 21 flights of fucking stairs. Usually you can go back up the elevator after the fire alarm is over.
That's true.
Oh, yeah, good point.
It took months for police to even request her phone. The iMac computer that Phoebe and Aunt shared was seized 4 months after her death. Police say they didn't take it that night because it was important to his privacy. Wouldn't you know, by the time they got it, all of Phoebe's outgoing emails had been deleted. The two partially filled glasses on the counter were not tested for prints. The blood found on the doorframe was tested and confirmed to be Phoebe's, but the mouse and mouse pad samples were never tested. Phoebe's Nokia phone was never recovered. A formal statement wasn't taken from the building manager until January 10th, 2012, so over a year later. Statements weren't taken by Aunt's closest contacts and employees until months after her death. The day after Phoebe's death was supposed to be her brother's birthday party. But instead of celebrating, Phoebe's entire family gathers to go to the morgue to identify her body. They reached out to Aunt many times to see if he wanted to join, but his mother always answered his phone and said that he was resting and couldn't speak with anyone. So back to the morgue. This is when the family learned that they are not considered her next of kin. At some point, Aunt registered for this to be changed to himself. Later this day, Aunt's mother calls Natalie to invite her to the Balencia in a few days to discuss next steps. Upon arrival, she's told that Aunt is too distraught to speak, so she should try again tomorrow.
You fucking invited me!
She goes back the next day, this time with a recording device that Lorne suggested Natalie bring. When discussing funeral arrangements, Natalie wanted a small and intimate service, while Aunt wanted something big and extravagant, almost like one of his events. When it doesn't sound like they are going to come to an agreement, he suggests that they have two separate services for her.
No, that is not normal, sir.
When Natalie asks to collect Phoebe's things, Aunt declines, stating that he has power of attorney over her belongings and how she is put to rest. Aunt agreed to have Phoebe's body released to the family, but refused to change next of kin status. 5 days after Phoebe's death, Aunt posts on Facebook. For those of you around the world who don't know the sad news, my partner Phoebe struggled with terrible depression much of her life. She took her own life on Thursday to ease her pain, to be at peace. There will be a memorial next week. He later told a friend of Phoebe's that this was the way she chose to do it because she thought she was garbage. The next day, police meet with Phoebe's family to relay the news that they did not find evidence of foul play and that Phoebe either killed herself or suffered an accident. Also on this day, the family receives an email from Aunt in which he expresses that he is hurt, that his next of kin status was challenged. He says he will permit them to organize funeral arrangements. He says that Phoebe would be horrified by how they are behaving. And apparently the Hamples were offended when the Handschucks requested a corner with no conflict of interest with Aunt's stepmother, being a serving judge with a connection to the coroner on Phoebe's case. In the days following this interaction, Natalie tried to reach out to make amends and explain her feelings and frustrations. That Aunt was never alone to where they could have a genuine conversation about Phoebe, that things were being held from them regarding the investigation, as Aunt was next of kin but not communicating with the family, that they weren't allowed any decision-making rights over her cremation. Now, there's no one way to grieve, but multiple people close to Aunt claim that his actions after Phoebe's death were completely dependent on who was around, specifically the Handschucks. One friend said she was shocked by his behavior in the presence of others, including one occasion when he went from checking his work emails and Facebook page to lying on the couch crying when one of Phoebe's relatives arrived at the apartment. and that it seemed he was turning his emotions on and off. Phoebe's autopsy found that her injuries were consistent with a fall down a narrow chute. Her lower body was impacted far more than her upper body. There were several broken bones, no evidence of sexual assault. Her blood alcohol content was 0.16, which is 3 times the legal driving limit there, and a normal amount of Stilnox. So potentially even taken the night before. Also trace of her antidepressant. We know in some cases these sleeping aids can cause odd behavior like sleepwalking, but you do things that you like would normally do, like eating or driving, not climbing into a trash chute.
I just can't connect those dots, but I do want to put out there it's possible.
Yeah. So on December 12th, Ant's memorial happens at the Royal Melbourne Yacht Club.
Of course it does.
Only some of Phoebe's family attended, and as expected, there was very little of actual Phoebe involved in this event. No pics prior to Ant, and apparently he was upset by a speech given by one of Phoebe's old friends because he was not mentioned in it. So December 16th, the Handshucks hold their service at the Old Abbotsford Convent, which was said to be much more of a peaceful event and more of what Phoebe would have wanted. Phoebe was cremated the next day. So shortly after, Aunt brings Natalie a box of Phoebe's belongings. But there is nothing of any sentimental value. None of her art, nor her passport, ID, or even her journals, which could have been enlightening to see how she was feeling before her death. It also comes out that Aunt put in a claim for Phoebe's death benefits.
To which he needs that damn money.
His dad signed a statutory declaration to back it up. However, it listed their relationship as starting 6 months before they even met. After a lot of pushback, he gave the $113,000 to Phoebe's 2 younger brothers. Phoebe's ashes were brought to Mallacoota, where her grandmother lived, and where she wanted to move to. Lynn is of Norwegian descent and built a Viking boat for the funeral. Her ashes were placed in the boat with letters from loved ones and set on fire on a lake that she loved. January 24th, Ant is brought in to be interviewed. Here he says that the iPhone was actually taken in on Thursday, the day Phoebe died, rather than the day before. So this would explain how she sent that text. However, it doesn't explain the call from Lynn about dinner that he swears was to the iPhone. The rest of his story remains the same. He has no idea why the key fob tracker didn't record his midday visit to check on Phoebe. So what we do know about the iPhone, the repair shop had no record of when the phone was dropped off, but was picked up on December 7th by Aunt's father. The phone was turned over to the police the same day, but it appeared that things had been deleted. For example, that odd text that Phoebe sent her family. So now I want to talk about the logistics of getting into the chute. I want you to try to picture it. The opening is at least 3 feet off the ground, and the door was 14.5 inches and opened up to 8 inches. The chute door is also spring-loaded, so you would have to hold it open to keep it from shutting automatically. Everybody agrees that she went in feet first, but the door would have slammed on her arms or hands, and she would have had injuries to show this. And remember, Phoebe's jeans were pulled down to her knees, so this makes getting her leg up to the door even more impossible. Another person who has a whole book of questions is Lorne, who is actually a retired detective. He was fighting this from every angle and was pissed that the police were not doing an investigation. He was so convinced of this not being an accident or suicide, calling it physically impossible and stating that her intoxication would have made it even less likely for her to get into the shoot. What do retired detectives do? They get shit done. On January 28, Lauren does an experiment at the Balencia on the actual trash chute.
What puzzled Lauren most is how anyone could physically commit suicide by rubbish chute.
You don't get a gap like this. It's going to be a pretty tight squeeze.
He enlisted friends of Phoebe, around the same height and weight, to help with his investigation.
Did she used to go that way? Is it easy for me to go that way?
Is it?
This is the actual rubbish chute on the 12th floor. It's 15 metres down the corridor from the apartment Phoebe shared with her boyfriend, Aunt Hamlin.
Are you stopping there by your body?
Yeah, my foot's on the end.
Yeah. What if you breathe in and wiggled yourself a little bit?
I've
got to run some experiments on this.
What about if your arms were up?
Because obviously the homicide squad's not going to do it because they've written it off.
No, I know. Someone got hold of
them. Time and again they tried.
We're not going to hold it, so don't worry. Try both ways. It's just one of those.
They tried facing one direction, then the other.
My problem is that the knees won't bend. Well, you're sitting on that trap now, aren't you?
Yeah, pretty much. Yeah. I'm still holding myself up with my left foot against the far wall.
Really? Yep. And when you say the far wall, that would be
my legs completely straight and not back.
They tried different body positions.
It feels like my body would have to hyperextend to get through. I'd have to arch my back heaps. I feel like I'd get stuck here if I went any further.
Multiple tests, including dropping a dummy from a 12th floor chute. It's seriously an angle.
Yeah. See, the legs have been crunched up.
Lauren was methodical. He even asked the chute manufacturer to build an exact replica of the chute for further tests.
200. The hatch and everything was exactly the same. And I took measurements of that at the time. But I was more concerned about the practicality of getting into it, because there are virtually no handholds.
With a lot of concentrated effort and a ledge to hold on to, finally she manages to squeeze in. Just. So you're saying it is possible?
Oh, it is possible. It is possible for a sober, fit person to get into that seated position.
So what doubts do you have, if any, that Phoebe actually did it with the intention of suicide?
She was drunk. She was drunk. She was 0.16% alcohol. That's pretty drunk as far as I'm concerned.
So any thoughts now that you've seen it and how tiny just the door is?
Just the idea of that being said as an accident is ridiculous to me, because it's very obviously not easy to get into. You really have to navigate. So you're not just going to fall into this thing that doesn't even stay open unless you're holding it open.
And so also, did you see how they were like grabbing all over the place, like on the walls, on the, like that makes it even harder for me to believe that there wasn't a usable print.
Also, yeah, because blood around the shoe at all?
No, there was blood on the door to the trash room, and then there were some drops in the trash room, but nothing was found around the door to the chute.
Was the blood on the door to the trash room tested? Because that was downstairs in the basement, right?
No. Think of it as in a hotel, the vending machine room or the ice room. It's like that, where you open the door and then you go in, and then there's the door to the chute that you pull down.
So
there was blood on the door to get into the trash room, and there were drops of blood on the ground. Nothing on the actual chute. That's why a lot of people think it was cleaned.
If we think she did it herself, which I don't think she but there would be blood, like she was already bleeding before she got herself in. Those are some brave friends of hers. I don't know if I would be like willing to go down a chute, especially the real one.
Yeah, they had the harness, but they still had, that would be terrifying.
Yeah, but just thinking, this is how my friend died.
At the last part of that video, when Lauren had that replica made, and she finally got all the way through, but like you said, it was spring loaded, and so when she had her arms up like that, the chute slammed on her arms.
What I noticed with the dummy thing, though, is they even had a hard time getting the dummy through, right? So my question is, if we're thinking that she could not have done this herself, could one person have maneuvered her into it? Because it seems like, especially if she was alive at the time, there would be some kind of fight or something. And it seemed like it was already a struggle to get the mannequin dummy in there who was not putting up a fight. You see what I'm saying?
Yeah. So I got one more video for you of another option that sounds like what you are implying.
One of Lauren's tests was to see how easy it would be for an unconscious person to be fed down the rubbish chute by someone else. What? That's what?
What was he trying to say?
That for somebody else to put in an unconscious person, it's a lot easier because you don't have to do the climbing and the balancing to get that leverage. And then the body weight is holding that.
The spring down spring because they're unconscious. Open,
and you just have to guide them through.
Gotcha.
But we're not sure that she was unconscious at the time, right? She was obviously not deceased because she was moving around once she was there. So she may have been unconscious and that fall may have woke her up, or she may not have been unconscious during the time of the fall.
Yeah. So one of the theories I saw was if she was unconscious, pulling the pants down could have been a way to keep her legs together and make it easier to feed her through. I know we saw Lauren allude to it, but like everybody interviewed has said, even though Phoebe drank a lot, she was a lightweight. She was known to be very clumsy and uncoordinated, even after just a few drinks. It was mentioned that she lost her sea legs pretty quickly, which I thought was the cutest Australian thing to say.
Speaking of Australian things to say, they call it a rubbish chute. And I've been trying to find a way to work that into the sentence. But
yeah. Rubbish chute and wheelie bins. So I know we saw this in one of the videos, but Lauren reached out to the manufacturer of the trash chute and had his replica made, which we just saw. And then I have a more extensive video with the replica.
Using a replica of the chute in Phoebe's building, Lauren wants to prove his point.
Do whatever you have to do to get into this. Really try hard to climb into it.
When you see it like that, it's very small, isn't it? I feel like I need to help you. Viv, Phoebe's close friend and her match in height and size, struggles, even though completely sober. What are you finding difficult at this point? Just trying to see how I can get my body in.
With the weighted door to the chute over a metre off the ground, the opening a mere 36 and a half centimetres, and nothing to hold on to, it takes a great degree of determination to even sit in it.
What a mission.
And once in, it's incredibly difficult for Viv to manoeuvre her entire body into the throat of the chute.
It's really squashing, like the, it's a bit of a...
You all right?
It's a tight squeeze to get in.
Yeah. Amazing. Oh, I just don't want you to get hurt. Oh, sweet. Okay?
Yes.
Jesus.
He's in it.
We've helped, which we shouldn't have done.
She was going to get injured if we didn't.
Yep. Stand up for us. Four steps aside.
I just don't believe that anyone could possibly do it under the influence. If you're a 0.16, there's no way you'd be able to handle that balance aspect of it. I just see that as being an amazingly complicated physical feat.
Janelle, remind me, wasn't she claustrophobic as well?
Yep.
Okay, thank you.
Yep, she was claustrophobic and she had a balcony.
So if that was truly what you wanted to do, jump off the balcony.
I don't want to be insensitive at all, but we know that Phoebe was not unfamiliar with drugs.
Right.
There's a million and seven other ways than to do something like this where you can see that's not like, I accidentally tripped and fell into the trash chute.
Could there have been the possibility that she did not think that it would end in her demise, that it could be a cry for help or attention? Because we know what is at the bottom of those chutes, right? Because of research. But I've lived in plenty of apartments that have had rubbish chutes, and I wouldn't know that there was a compactor thing down there. You know what I mean? So that kind of crossed my mind a little bit, as well as when people are under any kind of influence or distress, you become freakishly strong, right? You have abilities that you don't have before. So when everyone's testing these, they're testing them with a certain intent. They're not in crossy mode. They're not having a borderline personality disorder split. So I think those can play a factor into it.
Yeah, I was thinking that too, David, that almost saying that she was drunk or something like that would, to me, be more logical that she could do it then.
Could almost play into her favor.
I think the part about nailing into people that she was intoxicated is the physical whatever that it takes to actually make this happen. You probably wouldn't have that if you were that intoxicated.
Like, I see both sides of it. I feel like the alcohol could be how she was able to maneuver herself into the chute, but the alcohol would probably play a factor in preventing her to be able to get up to the chute. You know what I'm saying?
So like the balance that would take, because like it being 3 feet off the ground, like when we were watching The Friend in the reenactment, she has to put one leg up there first. Phoebe, and knowing what we know about her character from what her family and friends have said, is that she loses her sea legs quickly and is clumsy when she's drinking. That takes a lot of balance. I could just see her, even if she was trying to do that, to fall right over when she's putting one leg up. Because you're thinking about, you're putting one leg up, you're balancing on one leg, and you're intoxicated. That's difficult.
Not only that, but it's 3 feet up, right?
And your pants are down. Like, you can't move your...
Okay, and why would you your own pants down to jump into a garbage chute?
Right.
I'm still with you guys, but she didn't go head first. Because then I can see like pants coming off.
That's the one thing that everybody agrees upon, is the only way would have been feet first.
How do we know that when she hit the bottom, whether she did it herself or was put in, because obviously at some point she became conscious, right? How do we know that she was not trying to take her pants off to wrap her foot or something? How do we know her pants were pulled down before she was sent through the chute? If she came to and she was like, WTF, and saw that your foot is almost cut off, could maybe the pants and wrapping the foot be where she, in crossy mode and pain and all that, be thinking that I could wrap my foot in this, I can gain balance with this, I can stop bleeding with this?
Right. Potentially, if you think about it, she basically only had one leg to work with,
because that other foot was done. Yeah.
And so I would have looked for any other thing in that room, like my shirt, my whatever, before trying to even mess with
off,
having my pants pass over that foot.
And that's the thing. And that's why I get so stuck on these, is because we think, oh, logically, I would look for something else. But obviously, you're not in a logic state of mind in that situation. Right. We don't know how to think that way. So have I said damn it, Janelle, yet?
The other thing I want to talk about this video is, like, Lauren was holding down the chute at one point. So I don't know that her hands would have made it all the way through there. I feel like this spring would have definitely given it an abrupt stop at a minimum, and
then gave her bruises. you would have seen it on her hands and her. Right. Yep.
Because I saw him, like, he pressed down on it a little bit to allow her to pass through. So it didn't slam on her wrist. Because at that point, okay, you don't have enough body weight going back on it. So it's springing back up.
And again, those friends, I'm looking at that and I'm getting bruises all over my leg, just watching them trying to go down there. So you know they got hurt just trying to demonstrate.
For the record, I would do that reenactment for all of you, but.
Aw, I think that's a very sweet.
Yes, thank you.
I don't want to think about that, but.
Yeah, hopefully you never have to, but. I mean,
one of us will not be here, but that's sweet. Thanks, Jamie.
I love that, Jamie. But I just would not be able to fit in the chute myself.
I have one last demo. I feel like they all show like something a little different.
So to see what it would take to get into the chute, we've set up an exact replica of the 12th floor garbage chute in Phoebe's building. This is the test that the police failed to do.
Our the shade.
Danielle is the same height and weight as Phoebe and wearing similar clothes. The only difference is Danielle is sober.
Wow, it's very small.
And right from the beginning, Danielle is struggling.
Okay, I'm just trying to see what I can hold on to. It's not much around.
The chute is a meter from the ground and only 22 centimeters wide when open.
It's very tight.
Oh. I get you, Ruth.
Yeah.
Danielle's weight on the top lip of the door causes the limiting bolts to come out of their position, forcing the door to fall backwards, trapping her legs. With the door back this far, the chute entry is virtually closed.
Okay.
In her second attempt, Danielle pulls herself up, but it takes all her strength, balance, and coordination.
It's very tight. It's very, very tight.
Keep going.
It's closing on me.
And with limited movement, Danielle can only slide down the chute with her arms above her. A detail that will be of great interest to our
That gave me anxiety to watch.
Right. Yeah, Jamie, I would have given up already on the reenactment. Like, trying to get my leg up, I had to bend out.
Like, and even in this one, he had to hold the door so that it didn't slam her upper arms and fingers.
Did he have to do it, or did he just do it out of the fear of?
Yeah,
he probably didn't have to, but he didn't want this girl who just volunteered to do this thing for him to get injured.
Absolutely, it's the most respectful thing to do. However, that doesn't give us the true reenactment of what happened. When that's where I struggle.
Yeah.
And wasn't there 7 hours that this could have happened? So she could have been battling with this for 3 hours to get in and trial and error. We're not thinking it was just a 5-minute thing. Oh, I happened to just be able to one jump and slide in.
You're saying nobody from that floor came outside during that time?
Aren't they hidden away though?
It's in a room.
So you purposely go into that room for that rubbish chute. What also makes me wonder too, so if there's 7 hours, someone could have taken their trash and put it in a chute, right? So if there was a chair or something there, if they walked in this room and saw a chair, what the hell is this doing here, and drug it out, could there have been someone innocent minded thinking they're just throwing their rubbish down the chute, not realizing it was a crime scene and got rid of any potential evidence of something?
I was thinking that too. Is there a chance there was a stool or something in there?
They could be terrified to come forward and be like, oh, are they going to come after me?
And when the 4 months of no investigation or anything, no one's asking the right question. So that can give anybody a chance to forget.
I don't think this is something you forget. I think if this happens in your building, it's pretty memorable.
Yeah, fair enough.
Okay, so I don't know if you guys noticed in that last video when she collapsed the door, it squeezes in on the inside.
Yeah, she said her legs were trapped in there then. They had to physically help her out.
And that was built in as a safety measure. So I just want to make sure that you note that.
I did not catch on to that, so thank you.
So Natalie firmly believes that Phoebe's shoulders were too broad for her to fit with her arms down. And the only way would be with both arms above her head. However, Phoebe did not have dirt on her hands consistent with her hands being slid down a dirty, disgusting trash chute. Her thoughts on the jeans were that they were pulled down when she went in due to the fact that the cuts on her body did not match up to damage on the jeans. One theory is that she was unconscious when she was put in, arms up, jeans pulled down just in case she came to and tried to spread her legs to halt the descent. Natalie said that Phoebe had a cut on her right jawline and a subdural hematoma on the left side of her head, consistent with being unconscious for an amount of time. So another wild police situation, but 7 months after Phoebe's death, police are informed by the forensic team of a scrap of paper with a phone number that was found in the jeans she was wearing. No one recognized this number, and of course, it led to nothing by the time it was brought to attention. Popular theory is that it was someone that Phoebe bought drugs from.
I see that.
So I wanted to include this. Lynn found a poem in Phoebe's guitar case that he believed to be about Aunt. Perhaps all you needed was a form of flattery, which I gave to you without hesitation. I should have known. Thrown it in your face, how I usually despise men like you. Their fingering stares, wolf smiles, the swagger in their steps. I find that once I peel the layers off, there's nothing much left to hold, only an emptiness, a sense of nothingness. And somehow I, as your better half, am left to scrape all the pieces together and make you whole. I will not serve.
That was actually really beautiful.
So Phoebe's family appealed for a formal inquest into her death. Aunt was against this, so without traction there, Phoebe's family reached out to the media, and ta-da! An investigation was granted, and we have a formal inquest in August of 2013.
Wait, so they finally opened an investigation 3 years later?
3 years later.
I'm happy for them, but what can we fucking investigate? It's all gone.
It was also super difficult for the Handstrucks to get legal representation due to conflicts of interest because of relationships with either one or both of Aunt's parents. At the inquest, Phoebe's psychologist goes on record saying that shortly before her death, she had become worried about Phoebe and some comments she had made could be translated to suicidal ideation. Throughout the 3-week inquest, Aunt attended only 2 days, and one was because he was required to attend for questioning. He was actually given a certificate of immunity, which basically says any evidence or testimony you give in an inquest cannot be used against you.
How did he get granted that? I feel like there's some pulling of strings behind the scenes.
On the topic of Phoebe's iPhone, originally the software police used was unable to read the SIM card. They returned the phone to Aunt. By the time of the inquest, they believed they could retry with advances in technology. However, Aunt had given the phone away and lost the SIM card.
If you did at a time that there was no investigation, there was no talk of an investigation coming open, what would be the point of keeping it? I don't take it very suspicious that he doesn't have it.
Not 3 years later. No.
When discussing the iMac that Aunt and Phoebe shared, it's revealed that in October of 2010, this computer accessed a release of body form. So this is 2 months before Phoebe's death. Now, I'm sure you could find a way to explain it, but it definitely is an eyebrow raiser.
He did not have a true crime podcast, so I see no reason
for him
or her to be searching for that.
Yeah.
That is exactly what I was just thinking, Jamie. So I'm so glad you said that. Because side note, I was just like Googling about getting immunity for a coroner's inquest. So like now I got that weird Google search history, but there's a reason for it. I don't know what his reason would be to be Googling that.
Could that allegedly also have happened during the time that he was having the rights?
No, but this served before she died.
But when he became like the
power of attorney or whatever.
Power of attorney. So was this around the same time? Would that have influenced some kind of search or research?
I don't know when he applied for that, but I would think that is not the first thing on your mind.
Yeah, it's still not cute.
Yes, unless, I hate giving this fucker the benefit of the doubt. But unless you were searching, like David said, okay, I'm going to be like, power attorney is the wrong word, but we're just going to go with it. And I know that in doing that, I eventually will probably get her life insurance policy. And so what do I need to do to get that life insurance policy? Oh, I need to have this release of a body form. What does that look like? What do I need to prepare myself for? Again, I really fucking hate giving this guy a benefit of a doubt. But if you're going down a rabbit hole one night of what are all these things that I need, and then it goes to that. Maybe. I hate it. I don't love it. It probably isn't what fucking happened. But I'm sure some Johnny Cochran attorneys told you that's probably what happened.
I think this is the first time that we've met Brightside Jamie.
And I will say, with me coming to this blindly, you all already have preconceived notions of Aunt, right? But I guess with you saying you don't want to give the SOB the benefit of the doubt, that kind of leads me into what you potentially think. But where I'm at right now, not knowing anything, is he's a businessman. He is with lawyers and judges, and he owns businesses. Like, diving into these kind of researches, I think, would be normal.
That's the thing. We don't have the context. We have this one search. What are the searches around it? Is it something right, like he was saying, where he ends up on a website when he got the power of attorney, and then you're clicking through items on that website? A lot of state websites will have links on the side of click this, you can look at this, click this, look at that. What are the other searches? Or is it some like random Tuesday where he's like searching the best Chinese food and then searches this, and that's it. That's the only search he does.
Or could it be how to hide a body, how to put a body down in garbage chute, and how do I get a release of a body form? I'm with Carolina. I want to know the context around.
Yeah. So the concierge who found Phoebe testified that she took several weeks off afterwards to deal with the trauma. Upon her return, a man named Christo Van Egmond, who just happened to be one of Aunt's business associates / family friend of 25 years, and also fellow neighbor in the building, began bringing her gifts and pressuring her with questions about how she found Phoebe. He would tell her repeatedly that Phoebe's death was a suicide and she shouldn't feel bad. Things like Phoebe couldn't be saved. She didn't want to be saved. She basically had to tell him, go kick rocks. I'm not going to discuss this anymore. One of the hearings revealed that the visitor's log for December 2nd of 2010 went missing. Just those specific pages. The same concierge had also made a note in an incident log, which was ripped out later.
If you're so sure that it's suicide, then why do you need to take that shit away?
But if you're also so sure it's suicide, why would you want to leave it if it could point to you and you have a lot to lose? It could be a self protection mechanism kind of thing.
Preservation.
Like, yes.
So the assisting counsel to the coroner ruled that Phoebe's cause of death should be changed to open, which is like undetermined, meaning that it could be reinvestigated. She also ruled that the evidence wasn't strong enough to rule Aunt in or out of involvement. And while it is highly unusual for the coroner to go against the assisting counsel, the decision was overruled by the coroner and Phoebe's death remained an accident, citing that no one but Phoebe contributed to her winding up in the chute.
Was the coroner related to the Hamples at all?
There was a connection. Like, they had obviously been associates. Remember, yeah. The Hanschucks asked, can we get, like,
that's right.
Okay. Basically a non-biased coroner, and that offended them.
That's right. Okay, thank you.
The overruling in this is largely based on the mixture of sleeping pills and alcohol found in her body. It was even suggested that Phoebe got in the chute to try to shimmy her way down by controlling the fall. But we know her arms wouldn't fit by her sides, so this seems ridiculous. And on top of being intoxicated, Ant's attorneys pressed for a statement on him to be included in the coroner's report. Quote, no positive finding could be made on the balance of probabilities as to Mr. Hample's involvement. Bruises to the upper arms consistent with fingertips and forceful holding and carrying were noticed in photos when prepping for the inquest. This was overlooked at the initial review of Phoebe's injuries.
And that was not noted on the 85-page coroner's report. It came up after.
Correct. There were also bruises in various states of healing. Could it be from her being out on a bender and falling? Sure. But these grip mark bruises also could have been from a previous fight. While no one could prove foul play 100%, even the experts brought in believed there was no option other than open. And I didn't know this, but apparently in a case where cause of death is homicide, Google will recover deleted messages. But of course, this was not an option in Phoebe's case. So after the inquest, Natalie was advised not to challenge it with the Supreme Court. The family had attorneys willing to work pro bono. However, if she appealed and lost, she could be out hundreds of thousands of dollars in court costs. It's just gut-wrenching to hear her speak about having to back down on this when she knew it was wrong. Halfway through the releasing of the Phoebe's Fall podcast episodes in 2016, the AG brought up the need to revise the laws regarding appealing a coroner's findings to get a death reclassified. 18 months after the Phoebe's Fall podcast, the Coroner's Act got some major reforms, the podcast being a huge contributing factor for these amendments. So surrounding the length of time to appeal, it was 28 days and it was extended to 3 months. Also, the weight of evidence on a finding, and then families could now apply to change the wording on cause of death. And then also coroners can change rulings done under other coroners, which was not possible before. And while these things are all great, as far as Phoebe's case goes, this still doesn't change the fact that the family's livelihood could be demolished if they appealed and lost. And we can't forget, okay, we get it to the Supreme Court. Who used to be a judge on the court?
So why do we want to go that far to potentially lose?
I do want to mention Aunt's sister, Chrissy. So she and Phoebe had become really good friends, much to the dismay of Aunt. Now, it's said that Chrissy was a known coke dealer and user. Some also speculated that she might have had an inside source or connection, as she always seemed to know when the police were looking into her. Ant had essentially ended his relationship with Chrissy because of her activities and this investigation. He tried to enforce that Phoebe follow suit. But in August of 2014, Chrissy's home was raided following an extensive drug sting that caught multiple drug deals on hidden cameras. She was charged with 4 counts of trafficking cocaine. So she pled guilty and was sentenced to 200 hours of community service with the statement that the embarrassment to her family is punishment enough.
These fucking people.
In January of 2016, Chrissy posts on Facebook a picture of her and Phoebe. It was deleted after about 12 hours, but this is said to be the impetus to the Phoebe's Fall podcast, which reignited the need for justice for Phoebe. And I'll have a picture of that post for you guys in just a second. So in the years that follow, Aunt goes on to marry and get divorced. In 2016, 49-year-old Aunt began dating 23-year-old Bailey Schneider, a model and dancer, though he claims it was not a serious relationship. In June of 2018, Bailey is found dead. And not much information is available, but on a Friday night, she had gone to a party at one of Aunt's friends' homes without him. She's out all night and returns to the home she shares with her parents around 9 a.m. Her parents were about to head out for the day, and some sources say that they recall she and Aunt were having an argument on the phone. Others say that they had broken up the night before. I guess both could be true. But when they return, Bailey is found dead on the kitchen floor with a cord around her neck. The cord, however, is not attached to anything. Her toxicology report showed trace amounts of cocaine and blood alcohol levels close to Phoebe's, about 3 times the legal driving limit. The coroner acknowledges there are unusual factors, but no signs of foul play are suspected. And deja vu, it is immediately ruled a suicide.
So is it possible if you want to put something around your neck, can you strangle yourself by pulling it? So
it's self-asphyxiation.
Do people die by suicide that way? I feel like everybody does it by hanging, but has this ever been done?
It'd be hard to.
You would probably go unconscious, you know, before you died.
Yeah.
And you'd have control over it. You would have a reflex that would make you stop, yeah, probably.
I feel like you would do it enough until you went unconscious. But obviously when you go unconscious, you're not going to be able to pull any longer. So you're going to start breathing again.
Yeah.
However, depending on where you are, if you're doing that when you go unconscious, did you fall and hit your head? And that is what led to your death versus the actual
experience. This is too fishy to me. This was 2018. So this is 8 years later. And did he get married in between Phoebe, yep, and Bailey?
Any assault or domestic violence records with anything between
that time? Not that I heard of.
But who's his parents? Would there be record? Right.
And she's still alive, the ex-wife.
As far as I know. So no evidence was collected in Bailey's case, including her phone. Bailey had taken out a life insurance policy 3 weeks before her death, and that's pretty much all we know. It almost seems like a true crime in itself that more coverage is not available on Bailey.
Thank you for taking the time to listen to our show today. We genuinely appreciate any and all support. We would love if you would please subscribe, like, comment, or download on any of your favorite platforms that you go to for podcasts. Did today's episode leave you with more to say or have a theory that we didn't discuss or even a case that you'd love to hear us talk about? Head on over to our Facebook discussion group. You can search SWAC Pod, SWACPOD discussion group, and leave any suggestions, comments, etc. there. If you're a little bit more comfortable via email, we can also be reached at swacpod@gmail.com. That's SWACPOD@gmail.com. Any and all feedback is incredibly helpful to us. And until next time, stay curious, stay safe, and keep speculating wildly.